Okay, welcome everybody. It is my great pleasure to welcome David Yates, who has been a visitor already last week and who has visited this week as well to the Space and Time After Pornography project. David did his PhD at King's College London in 2006 and then had postdoc positions at Sheffield, Oxford, King's College.
I was a lecturer at Sheffield, a postdoc, then a lecturer at King's, and then a postdoc at Oxford.
Okay, then a postdoc at Oxford in Alamogoro's project, and is now an FCT researcher at the University of Lisbon. He works on philosophy of mind, philosophy of science, especially the philosophy of neuroscience, metaphysics, and has published on things like the downward causation, dispositional essentialism, causal exclusion, and a number of other things. Today he will be speaking about spacetime functionalism and empirical coherence. Please, David.
Thank you very much, Chris. Thanks for the invitation to come and speak here today. Thanks for hosting me. It's been really cool. It's been really educational. So I apologize in advance for any coughing fits that might happen during this talk. I have a bit of a cold, which will not out, I'm clear. So I know everybody says this before every philosophy talk ever, but this time it's true. This is actually a work in progress. But it's not so much in progress that I don't know what the structure of the paper will be. It's just there are certain points at which the arguments aren't quite as well worked out as they will be in the written version. Nonetheless, I want to give you a flavor of the... I can certainly give you the structure of the arguments and how I think it's all going to work today. So let me just kind of give you a taste of where I'm coming from to locate what I'm going to say within the debate. So you often hear it said that space-time is emergent in certain theories, particularly quantum gravity, loop quantum gravity, maybe certain versions of string theory. And emergent in the physicist's sense of the term is typically taken not to mean the same thing as it does for metaphysicians. When metaphysicians talk about emergence, traditionally in philosophy you imagine it's a relation between two entities. There's some base entities, there's some emergent entity, and there's a real relation that obtains between them of some kind, and you call that emergence to distinguish it from other relations, like realization or causation. Physicists, when they talk about emergent space-time, they don't tend to mean that, as far as I can tell. But they tend to mean that the emergent space-time is in some sense merely phenomenological, not really real, merely apparent. So when physicists start telling you that space-time is emergent in that sense, you quite quickly get problem of empirical coherence that I'm going to be talking about today. So if space-time isn't really real, if it's merely apparent, merely phenomenological, then a lot of the claims that we make about space-time, if they're true at all, are going to be made true by some non-spatiotemporal fundamental ontology. And space-time functionalism, at least in one or two of its variants, can be seen as an attempt to give a truth-making account for spatiotemporal claims, which doesn't appeal to spatiotemporal properties, which is consistent with space-time being emergent in this physicist sense of the term, being merely phenomenological. As against that, there's a more common sense view, which is the view that I'm going to be arguing for today, which is that, look, if the fundamental ontology isn't space-time, then what we should say is that space-time is a grounded, possibly non-fundamental, I'll come to that at the end, it's a grounded entity, but it's really real. It's just not really of the same ontological status as the fundamental things. I take it this is something like Tim Maudlin's view, but I'm not so sure about that. In any case, it's what I'm going to be arguing for today. And so in order to do that, I'm going to argue against this truth-making story that I take certain space-time functionalists to be trying to tell. I'm going to argue that that doesn't work. So on the assumption that there are empirical truths about this, about manifest spatiotemporal things, there has to be something more or less corresponding to a manifest spacetime that they inhabit, and their properties within that are what make our spatiotemporal claims true. So that's the general flavor of what I'm going to be trying to do. I'm going to give you what I take to be a novel argument for a very common sense position about the truth makers for ordinary spatiotemporal claims, ordinary claims about our manifest spacetime and the things that seem to live in it. So here's the structure of the talk. I'm going to start talking about something which I take is very familiar to all you guys and which I'm sure that everybody in the audience knows more than me about, so I'm not going to dwell on this stuff, just to give you an idea of the problem of empirical incoherence that seems to arise if space-time isn't fundamental in quantum gravity. I'm going to recast it in terms of truth-making. I'll explain to you why I'm doing that, give you some motivation for doing that. It's quite important for what I'm doing today that it can be so recast. But I hope that's going to be fairly uncontroversial. Then I'm going to distinguish three kinds of space-time functionalism that you can isolate in the literature. Dare I use the pointer? No, I'm not going to. It's the red button, right?
Yes.
Okay. I'm going to distinguish space-time functionalism properly so-called, which is the position defended by Alan Knox, from object and property functionalisms. And these are the kind of functionalisms that you see in David Chalmers and Alyssa Ney's work. And in particular, I'm going to suggest that even though the proponents of these positions refer to them as versions of space-time functionalism, they can plausibly seem to be diametrically opposed. Space-time functionalism versus object and property functionalism are driving in very, very different directions. Then I'm going to argue against property functionalism. So I'm going to offer you one argument that spatiotemporal property terms don't have functional specifications. They're not functional specification concepts. They don't have the kind of functional analysis that Dave Chalmers and I think Alyssa Ney takes them to have. And then I'm going to go a step further. I'm going to argue that they're actually more or less transparent concepts, to some degree transparent concepts. At least some spatiotemporal property concepts are more or less transparent, pick out their reference as the properties that they are. And on that basis, I'm going to argue that if the fundamental ontology isn't spatiotemporal, then there'd better be a grounded spacetime which has the kind of properties, which contains the local beables that have the kind of spacetime properties that are the truth makers for the sort of spacetime claims we typically make. Okay, so this is the bit that I think is very familiar. Science seems to propose local beables, things that live in the space-time of the manifest image, meters, pointers, dials, and things like that. And the evidence propositions, the evidence for our theories, the pointer moves to position 5 on the dial, they're always really spatiotemporally loaded claims. They seem to be making claims about the spatiotemporal properties entirely of local beables. I take it this is all very familiar, so I don't want to dwell on it too much. So various theories of quantum gravity, loop quantum gravity, string theory. Like I said, I could talk a bit more about these, but I suspect that you guys all know more about this than I do, so I don't really see why, but maybe I can say a bit about it. So, loop quantum gravity, as you guys, for the benefit of anyone who might be watching the video who doesn't know about this stuff, I take it loop quantum gravity has got some space-timey elements in there. You've got little primitive areas, primitive volumes. So it is kind of a bit space-timey, but as I understand it, even if you take an eigenstate of the spin foam, the adjacency relations in the spin networks don't map onto adjacency relations in space-time of the manifest image. So the structure of the fundamental entity, even if you take an eigenstate thereof, looks to be very, very different to the structure of manifest spacetime. And then what's even worse is that, according to loop quantum gravity, the fundamental ontology is a huge superposition of states like that. So it's a big superposition of states, which even if you're in one of those eigenstates, don't map in a neat and tidy way onto the space-time of the manifest image. So you have some reason there for suspecting that space-time is not fundamental according to loop quantum gravity. And now you get this threat of empirical coherence. If there's no space-time in the fundamental ontology, then it doesn't look like there's anywhere for the local beables to live. Where do meters, pointers, and rods and clocks live? How do we manage to say things that are true about, apparently, about their spatiotemporal properties if space-time is not fundamental? So I take it this is all quite familiar. The problem of empirical coherence is that the theory, if it were true, seems to undermine the very possibility of its being justified. Because the things that we look at to support these theories are inevitably things in the manifest space-time that we seem to inhabit. So, here are two possible solutions to that kind of empirical incoherence problem. You can either deny that empirical coherence requires anything like local beables in the sense of things located in a 3+1 dimensional manifest space-time. According to this option, we can make sense of the empirical justification of theories even if all of this stuff is somehow merely apparent, if it's merely phenomenological, if it's not really real, if it's just a simulation, as is sometimes claimed. And the functionalist approaches that I want to argue against can be taken in just this way. They're attempts to, I think, attempt to provide a truth-making theory for ordinary spatiotemporal claims that doesn't require the existence of anything like the manifest space-time. Alternatively, you can take a common sense path, which is the one that I prefer, the one that I'm going to argue for, and say that local beables live in an emergent space-time, which is very much like the space-time of the manifest image. It's the space-time that we inhabit. And I'm going to offer you a more or less conceptual argument for option two here. It's not purely conceptual. It depends on a kind of heavyweight claim about empirical claims. Like when I say the meter moves to position 5 on the dial, I'm making a claim that's literally true. So that's what's going to be doing the heavyweight lifting in the argument. But it's not purely conceptual. The idea, roughly, is that we can make true claims using concepts that don't refer functionally, that refer more or less transparently to spatiotemporal properties. And the only way for them to be true is if the properties they pick out are spatiotemporal in character. So that's a broad overview of the argument. I'm going to give you a more or less conceptual argument for what I take to be a very common sense position about the status of space-time, assuming that the fundamental ontology isn't spatiotemporal. So, as promised, I'm going to connect up empirical coherence with truth. And I'm going to say that quantum gravity is empirically coherent only if there are true empirical propositions. Sometimes this is framed in terms of the existence of local beables. I don't want to put it like that. I want to put it in terms that everybody will accept. I think functionalists accept these terms as well, which is why they're trying to offer a truth-making story that doesn't depend on the existence of a manifest space-time. I'll come back to that. So one argument I could give you in favor of this connection between empirical coherence and truth is just Bayesian confirmation theory. If you're a good Bayesian about confirmation, then you set the probability of the theory given the evidence to the probability of the evidence given the theory multiplied by the ratio of the priors. But if the empirical claims aren't literally true, it's very difficult to see how that sort of Bayesian confirmation story can be made to work. So I take it good Bayesians are going to need true empirical propositions. You have to be able to attach probabilities to the truth of empirical propositions. If they're true in some weird sense, like true in the simulation, you have some fancy truth predicate like that, it's not at all obvious why the probability of truth in the simulation would correlate with probability of literal truth, which is what we want for the theory itself. So I think on standard Bayesian accounts of confirmation, you need true empirical propositions. So So I'm going to say that's a necessary condition. It's not sufficient, because we also need those true empirical propositions to be entailed, or rather, we need the empirical propositions to be entailed by the theory, whether they're true or not. But obviously, I'm not going to address that. That's a matter for physicists. Today, I'm just going to think about the conditions under which empirical propositions are true, i.e. propositions that seem to be about things in a manifest 3+1-dimensional space-time. So now we can formulate the problem of empirical coherence in a different way. How can there be true empirical propositions about things like meters and pointers and stuff if the fundamental ontology isn't spatiotemporal? So if fundamentally there doesn't exist a space-time resembling this phenomenological thing, then where do things like meters and pointers live, and how can we make true claims about them? Okay, so let's go back to the two possible solutions that I mentioned earlier. And we can think of these usefully in terms of the truth-making notion that I just outlined, the truth-making necessary condition on empirical coherence. If you want to deny that empirical coherence requires anything like local beables, anything like the manifest, you want to say that this is all purely phenomenological, this is kind of an illusion of some sort or a simulation, then you need to say that empirical truths have non-spatiotemporal truth-makers. And that's where I see certain brands of functionalism as fitting into this debate. If you want to go the common sense route, like me, as a good common sense metaphysician, and say that local beables live in an emergent 3+1-dimensional space-time, which is kind of similar to what we think, similar to the way in which we conceptualize it, then empirical truths have spatiotemporal truth-makers, but those truth-makers are themselves grounded. They're non-fundamental there. They're made true by grounded entities that live in a grounded space-time that have grounded spatiotemporal properties. So you might think of this as reductionist versus non-reductionist. I think that might be a useful way of thinking about it. But I think that functionalists and non-functionalists alike will agree that empirical truth is necessary for empirical coherence. In order for quantum gravity to be empirically coherent, they've got to be true propositions about, prima facie, about things living in a manifest spacetime. So the difference between the two positions can be cashed out in terms of whether you think those truths have spatiotemporal or non-spatiotemporal truth makers. Okay, so let me distinguish three kinds of functionalism that I think you can find in the literature. So the one I'm calling space-time functionalism is Ellen Knox's position. And she thinks that the concept of space-time is a theoretical concept that refers by means of a causal role. Okay? It's the occupant of the space-time role in physical theory. There are a bunch of roles that you might associate with the concept of space-time, like determining the inertial paths, the inertial structure. Okay? So space-time is whatever determines the inertial paths, whatever determines how bodies move when they're not subject to a force. That's the space-time structure. There are a range of other roles that Knox talks about in the manuscript on this. But I think it's determining inertial paths that's really the main one. It determines the structure of the inertial frames. But in addition to that, you can find these other positions referred to as space-time functionalisms too. So Ney says that she's going functionalist about space-time in certain points, especially in the 2012. In particular, she thinks that in the 2012 paper, I have a bibliography at the end of this, by the way. She thinks that ordinary objects can be identified in configuration space by means of their roles. I'll say causal roles for now. There's some caveats associated with that, but let me say causal roles for now. So, ordinary objects can get identified as bits of the wave function, as little areas of high amplitude of the wave function, by means of their causal roles in the manifest image. And then there's property functionalism, which is Dave Chalmers' view, which is thinking properties like the property of being on the left, or the property of being a meter apart, the property of being spherical, are concepts of these properties. We pick them out by means of phenomenology. So the properties in question are identified as whatever normally causes the property of being a sphere. is whatever normally causes sphere-ish phenomenology. And this property-functionalist view is very much like the way we now think about colours. We don't think about colours as smeared over the surfaces of objects anymore. We don't think of phenomenal colours that way. We think colours are real properties. I mean, there's something like reflectance profiles of surfaces. But the reflectance profile of a surface is not literally phenomenal redness. That's the property that gives rise to phenomenal redness. So the idea is that the phenomenal redness that we experience when we look at a red apple, we use that to secure reference to color properties. So the color property itself is whatever feature of these objects it is that normally gives rise to that kind of phenomenology. And Chalmers, in his 2012 Constructing the World, says the same thing about space-time properties. And I'll say a bit more about why he says that as I go on. So let me say a little bit about Ney's 2015 position and why I think that she's best thought of as a property functionalist in much the same boat as Chalmers. So she thinks we can identify things like the state of a measuring device, okay, like the pointing to position 5 on the dial, by means of functional roles. She thinks we can identify that stuff in configuration space by means of a certain causal functional role. Okay? But she also thinks that all this is just a simulation. Okay, so the space-time of the manifest image is not really real. It's kind of an illusion. It's merely apparent, merely phenomenological. She actually explicitly calls it a simulation. It's like, in Jaegwon Kim's terms, it's like a series of shadows cast by a moving car, right? It's not, these are not real causal interactions, or if they are. Maybe I shouldn't go that far. Given that she thinks all that about the space-time of the manifest image, it seems reasonable to suppose that she's really cashing out reference in terms of phenomenology in the same way that Chalmers is. You know, what is it for two things? It's, things really only have phenomenological causal roles in the manifest image. Those roles aren't literally occupied by anything in the fundamental reality, which for her is configuration space. But she thinks we can refer to things in configuration space by means of this purely phenomenological stuff. Well, how's that possible? The answer is, she's securing reference by means of phenomenology, the same way that Chalmers does. Things and their spatiotemporal properties and relations, we can identify those in a fundamentally non-spatiotemporal, well, maybe not, in the case of configuration space, maybe not, but we can identify things within configuration space for Ney by means of the way the manifest image seems, by means of the phenomenology. And that, to me, puts her in the same boat as Chalmers. But I'm not entirely clear about Ney's view on this. She certainly thinks objects can be identified functionally, and she certainly thinks that states of measuring devices can be. And that seems to me to suggest that she's both an object and a property functionalist. So all these functionalisms have some features, a feature, in common, which I like to call topic neutrality. Topic neutrality is an old term from the philosophy of mind. Actually, I don't know how familiar you guys are with this stuff, but it started life as a linguistic term. Basically, the topic neutral words in a conversation are those such that if you only heard those words, you wouldn't know what the conversation was about. If, but, and, when, all that stuff. And then J.J.C. Smart and David Lewis, David Armstrong, borrowed this notion of topic neutrality to explain how the identity theory of mind could be true. So the identity theorists were puzzled, okay, initially. How could a phenomenal experience turn out to be identical to a brain state? Why am I not aware a priori that it's a brain state? Well, one story you can tell about that. How can the identity be a posteriori is that one of the concepts is topic neutral. It picks out its referent by means of a role, by means that are not kind of, that don't relate to the essence of the state. So in J.J.C. Smart's famous example, when I say something like, I see a yellow after image, what I'm saying literally has the content. I'm in the state that I normally go into, whatever that might be, when I look at a banana under normal lighting, blah, blah, blah. You're not specifying the essential nature of the state, and then you discover through neuroscience that it's a particular pattern of brain activity. And these functionalisms have that topic neutrality in common. So Knox functionalism is Spacetime functionalism proper, as I'm calling it, is neutral about the nature and ontological status of spacetime. Spacetime is whatever occupies the spacetime role, determining the inertial paths and such like within general relativity. That could be something fundamental, and it might be a non-fundamental grounded structure. The concept itself is neutral about the ontological status and nature of the thing that occupies the role. And likewise, object and property functionalisms are neutral about the nature and ontological status of things and properties. You identify them as the occupants of roles, whatever they might be like. So the common sense causal roles can be occupied by things that aren't located in a 3 plus 1 dimensional space-time, in the space-time of the manifest image, i.e. by regions of high amplitude of the wave function on configuration space, for name. And for Chalmers, he thinks his view applies to quantum gravity, right? So we can use spatiotemporal concepts to pick out states of the fundamental ontology, even if that's completely non-spatiotemporal. Spatiotemporal concepts are concepts of whatever it is that normally gives rise to such and such space-time phenomenology. And that can turn out to be very different to the way we experience those properties. So there's no restriction on what the fundamental ontology has to be like. What matters is that the roles are occupied somehow. But I want to try and drive a wedge between these two kinds of functionalism. Having spoken to Eleanor about it last weekend, she's really not trying to do the same thing that the other functionalists are trying to do. There's a real divide. Although all three positions have this topic neutrality feature in common, what Eleanor's trying to do with her version is very different to what the other guys are trying to do with theirs, and I just want to say quickly a bit about that. So, space-time functionalism blocks the following inference. Okay, it blocks the inference from the fundamental ontology isn't spatiotemporal to there's nowhere for the local beables to live. What occupies the space-time role might be a non-fundamental structure. So, turns out that loop quantum gravity is the right way of thinking about the fundamental ontology, and that turns out to be non-spatiotemporal. On a functionalist view, it doesn't follow that there's nowhere for the beables to live. Provided something occupies the space-time role, for Knox, it's the metric field she thinks is the likeliest candidate. She's a kind of a substantivalist about the metric field. And that's a non-fundamental structure if loop quantum gravity turns out to be the right story about the fundamental ontology. So the occupant of the space-time role can be non-fundamental. So this is kind of making room for a grounded space-time view. Okay, treat space-time as a functional concept, then argue that something non-fundamental could play the relevant role in general relativity, and then you don't necessarily have to worry if the fundamental stuff turns out to be non-spacetime. That just means that something grounded might occupy the spacetime role. Object and property functionalists are not really doing that, as far as I can tell. Certainly, Ney and Chalmers want to try and make sense of the truth of empirical claims about a prima facie spatiotemporal ontology that doesn't require the existence of anything like a manifest spacetime. So object and property functionalism combine to allow us to make true empirical claims based on the phenomenology, based on how things seem to us in the manifest image. So whatever properties you can attribute, whatever properties bring about certain types of spatiotemporal phenomenology, to whatever occupy the phenomenological thing roles. And the truth maker of claims like that can be something very different to the way we experience it, something non-spatiotemporal in the fundamental ontology. So like I said, I think there's, although they're referred to as functionalist theories of space-time by their proponents, it's kind of in its infancy, this stuff, and we need to be careful. We need to distinguish between the kind of functionalism that Eleanor Knox is arguing for and the kind of functionalism that the likes of Chalmers and Ney are arguing for. Because in Knox's view, if the fundamental ontology turns out to be completely non-spatiotemporal, then perhaps what we should say is that a grounded structure occupies the space-time role, and hence is the space-time of the theory. But on the Ney-Chalmers view, we don't need a grounded structure. Because we can, the truth makers for our, because our concepts, all of our empirical space-timing concepts, are topic neutral. They're all neutral about the nature and ontological status of the referent. They can all be true without a grounded space-time. We can somehow pick out the stuff in the fundamental ontology directly by means of these topic neutral concepts. Just like your concept of being in pain on the David Lewis view. Pain is the occupant of the pain role, whatever it might be. When you say I'm in pain, you make a true claim, even though the Cartesian theory of mind is completely false. You don't have any kind of privileged access. You're picking out a physical state of your brain using a topic-neutral mental concept. And just the same thing is going on here. So we need to distinguish these two types of functions, I think. Okay. So I want to let you know that property functionalism doesn't work. Let me just go back to the previous slide for a second. This, what I have here on the space-time, is not necessarily Knox's view. It's a view that Knox wants to leave open. The occupant of the space-time role is a non-fundamental structure. That's the view that I want to argue for. So I don't attribute that to Knox here. That's the view that I want to argue for, and I'm going to do it by arguing that the object, what I have here under object property, isn't going to work because spatiotemporal concepts are not topic neutral. The topic neutral theory of spacetime concepts doesn't work. I'm going to argue for that on two independent grounds. I'm first going to argue that there's no topic neutral analysis, no non-circular topic neutral analysis of certain spatiotemporal concepts. And then I'm going to argue independently that we should think of those concepts are probably more or less transparent, at least partially transparent to their reference. So those two things together are going to be an argument for this common sense view that I have here under space-time. Okay, so in Chalmers' view, concepts like spherical refer to whatever normally causes spherish experiences. There's a hint of circularity about that. But the concept spherical and the concept spherish are not the same thing. Okay, it's like the concept of red is the concept of whatever normally causes reddish experiences, where reddish refers to the phenomenal property of the experience that you're using to secure reference to the physical objective color property of the thing itself. So it's not circular because red, spherical and spherish are different concepts. This refers to the phenomenology. This refers to whatever normally causes it. And this is Chalmers' view on space-time properties. I'll come back to the notion of twin earthability shortly. He thinks these concepts are, So he thinks these concepts are topic neutral. He thinks they're functional because he thinks they're twin earthable. Twin earthable just means that it can be used to construct twin cases. Concept of water, for instance. In Putnam's famous twin earth case, you imagine a world phenomenologically identical to actuality, but in which the water role, the functional role of water, is occupied by XYZ, a different chemical substance, but with all the same phenomenological features that taste the same, looks the same stuff. And then you ask, what does the twin earthers concept of water refer to? And it seems quite clear that it refers to XYZ for them. They mean something different by their concept water than we mean by ours. So if you can construct a case like that, then a concept is probably referring topic neutrally. Okay? It's referring without picking out the substance as the substance it is, but by picking out the substance as the occupant of a certain role. So water, you know, it's just the concept of the tasteless, odorless, colorless liquid that falls from the sky, flows in Lake Geneva, and so on, whatever that might be. And that's what it is to be a topic-neutral concept. So if you can construct twin earth cases for a concept, it's a good sign that it's topic-neutral, that it refers by a kind of a role specification rather than transparent. So I want to argue now that there are at least some spatiotemporal concepts that can't be analyzed in that way. It can't be analyzed in terms of phenomenology. I'm going to pick on relative motion and contact, two very kind of common sense spatiotemporal concepts that we use to make claims about things like measuring devices. On Chalmers' view, these better have phenomenological reference fixes, at least. And I don't think they do. I certainly don't think they can be analyzed in terms of the phenomenology that they normally cause. So this is Chalmers' example, Chalmers' argument for the topic neutrality of spherical. So suppose there's an absolute reference frame. Special relativity is true, but there's an absolute reference frame. You imagine the Earth is moving, say, in the northward direction, the direction of the North Pole, at 0.87 C. Then it follows that it's compressed by, it contracts by 50% along its north-south axis. And because there's an absolute reference frame with respect to which the Earth is moving, we're just supposing that for the sake of argument, the Earth is absolutely non-spherical. But the question is, what should we say about the truth value of the proposition the Earth is spherical on all of those assumptions? Chalmers says that, look, we shouldn't say in that case that they're subject to a persistent illusion. If all that were true, we wouldn't be wrong in saying that the Earth is roughly spherical. What we ought to say about that case is that spherical picks up, the concept of sphericality picks up a property other than being a sphere. It picks up the property of being a, what's a squashed sphere? Is there a word for that? Spheroid. No word for this? Okay. Anyway. So even under these assumptions, we should still say the proposition that the Earth is spherical is true, which means that spherical refers to whatever normally causes spherish experiences. So the argument is that a certain kind of persistent illusion is impossible with concepts like spherical, even if you imagine that we're moving with respect to an ether, and Lorentz contracted by 50% along our north-south axis, it's still true to say that the Earth is roughly spherical. And what that means is that the concept of sphericality is topic neutral. It would still appear spherish to us if all that was true, because all our measuring rods would be contracted as well. We just wouldn't notice. Okay. So that's the gist of, that's a Chalmers style argument for the topic neutrality of shape concepts. I'm not persuaded by it. Maybe we'll come back to that later, but I don't want to dwell on that. I want to grant that sphericality, the concept picks out whatever normally causes spherish experiences, and I want to ask whether this kind of theory could be true of concepts like contact and relative motion. And I'm going to suggest that it's not. So start by thinking what the phenomenology would be in these cases. In the case of sphericality, it's maybe plausible to suppose that there's a kind of a way that there's a sort of a phenomenology associated. When we apply the concept of a sphere, there's a certain sort of symmetry, appearance. In Lorentz Earth, you know, the Earth would still appear symmetrical to us in space. Kind of see this, it seemed like it was the same in all directions. So you can maybe buy that there's a reference-fixing phenomenology in the case of a concept like sphericality. But I very much doubt that there's any such phenomenology in the case of concepts like relative motion and contact. So, here's a quick argument for that. The kind of argument that I have in mind here is very similar to the circularity objection to logical behaviorism. For those of you not familiar with philosophy of mind, behaviorists thought that we could analyze mental states in terms of dispositions. Me wanting some water is me being disposed to pick up this bottle and take a swig. Okay. Except that it's not. I'm only disposed to do that if I also believe that there's some water in the bottle. So I can only tell you what dispositions go along with wanting some water based on other mental states. Which dispositions I have on the basis of one mental state depend on the totality of my mental states. The circularity objection to logical behaviorism, a position that nobody ever really held, but is often held up as what Wittgenstein thought, it's a straw man. We needn't concern ourselves with that. And I think a similar circularity objection will apply in the case of space-time phenomenology. So what does being in contact look like? What phenomenology does it normally give rise to? Well, imagine two perfect planes of glass being in contact. That looks one way. Imagine two spheres being in contact. That looks another way. It's a different phenomenology in each case. So the phenomenology of being in contact is going to depend on the other spatiotemporal properties of the contacting thing. It's also going to depend on where the observer is in relation to them, which is another set of spatiotemporal properties again. So no sooner have you started saying, look, you want to say that contact is the property that normally causes contactee phenomenology. But what's the phenomenology? I say you can't specify it without presupposing a whole bunch of other spatiotemporal stuff. So that's going to be a circularity problem very similar to the one that faces behaviorists. If you compare that with water, I mean, water, it plausibly is the case that water is the concept of whatever substance falls from the sky and so on and so forth. And I don't need to pick out any other natural kinds to do that. I can specify the phenomenology of water in pretty neutral terms. It's the tasteless stuff that comes out of the tap. But I just don't think that's true for spatiotemporal properties. Two spheres in contact can look like that. You can see a little dark point in the middle if you're looking directly at them. You rotate them a bit like that. They might still look like they're in contact, but it's a different phenomenology because you can't see the dark contact point anymore. If they're transparent spheres, they might look completely different again. There just isn't spatiotemporal phenomenology corresponding to individual space-time properties like being in contact. Relative motion is the same. What does something being in motion away from me look like? You might say, well, it looks like it's getting smaller. But what if it's also expanding as it moves? You know, it's the phenomenology that correlates with properties like being in motion, being relative motion, being in contact, depends heavily on other spatiotemporal properties. There's no non-circular account of the phenomenology of a given spatiotemporal concept. So they don't refer in this phenomenological way that Chalmers supposes. Now you might say, well, what about the scientific roles? Maybe the concept of contact picks out whatever property is necessary for some certain types of causal interaction, transfer of momentum or something like that, transfer of energy maybe. There are certain locality constraints on causality, I take it. Even if you think that entanglement phenomena give you non-local causal interactions, you still have some locality constraints on other kinds of causality. The ones that involve transmission of a signal are still going to have locality constraints attached. So you might suppose that the concept of contact or locality picks out whatever property is responsible for those constraints. The problem with this view is that it won't explain how it is. This is supposed to be a theory of what defines the concept. The concept of sphericality for Chalmers literally is a priori definable as the concept of whatever gives rise to spherish phenomenology. So not only is the phenomenology not there, but if you go scientific about the concept, then you have no way of explaining folk competence with it. How is it that people are able to apply that concept when they don't know the scientific role in question or what occupies it? So the scientific story won't work either. So what I think about this is that there are at least some spatiotemporal concepts such that they're not definable in terms of phenomenology, because there is no stable phenomenology associated with some spatiotemporal properties, like being in contact, like being in relative motion. There is no unique way that looks. The way it looks depends on the other spatiotemporal properties of the situation. If you try and do it scientifically, forget it, because this is your concept, okay? It's my concept, it's my mum's concept, right? It's everybody's concept. The concept of being in contact or relative motion, these are concepts that we can all apply. You go scientific about the definition, all of a sudden they're deferential concepts that most people don't know how to use or apply, like electrons, plausibly such a concept. The folk don't know how to apply that, they defer to scientists, you know? But ordinary spatiotemporal concepts just aren't like that. So I think the property functionalism fails. I don't think there's any functional way of picking out space-time properties. You can't do it with phenomenology, you can't do it with scientific roles. I don't have time to talk about this. In the written version of this paper, I'm going to talk about things like the Kripke-Putnam account, because all I've argued against so far is the idea that you can define spatiotemporal concepts, either in terms of phenomenology or scientific roles. You might still say they have that they refer topic neutrally without being defined by the reference fixes, Vidas, Kripke, and Putnam. So I don't want to talk about that now. There are arguments against the Kripke-Putnam view as well that I have applied to spatiotemporal concepts. Let me just quickly run through one. Okay, so on the Kripke-Putnam story, you fix reference to the natural kind of water by saying anything that stands in the same liquid as relation to the stuff in this bottle, for example. So now suppose I try and fix reference to the property of being in contact by saying anything that stands in the same property as relation to the property that this n-tuple, this pair of things now has. But which property is that? This pair of things has loads of properties. Not all of them are spatiotemporal. If I want to fix reference to the property being in contact like that, I've got to say something like, well, contact, I'll use the term, the concept contact to refer to anything that's spatiotemporally like these things. But now I'm just appealing back to spatiotemporal notions again. So I've got a spatiotemporal way of fixing reference to a spatiotemporal property. So I think that's going to fail, and I think the same thing about reference magnetism views is going to fail here as well. But instead of going through the detail of that, I'm just going to give you a pretty simple argument, direct argument, that at least some space-time concepts are transparent. At least partially transparent to their reference. They pick out spatiotemporal properties as the properties that they are. That is, they don't refer by means of roles. They don't refer topic neutral. they provide, at least some of our spatiotemporal concepts provide at least some epistemic access to the natures of the properties that they refer to. Okay? So I've argued that certain specific topic neutral analyses fail. Now I'm going to argue from the other direction. They fail because the concepts are transparent. Okay. So I'm going to depend on a heuristic of Dave Chalmers. It's a caetus paribus claim. Caetus paribus concepts epistemically transparent if and only if it's not twin earthable. Twin earthable concept, like I said before, is one for which you can construct a twin earth scenario, such that the people in the scenario are not making a systematic error. So when I imagine that the tasteless stuff that falls from the sky is really X, Y, Z, is a different chemical compound, I'm not imagining a scenario in which everybody is wrong to say, there's some water in my glass. There's no H2O there, right? It's just X, Y, Z occupying the water role. So you get two options, either all the people at twin earth are making a mistake when they say there's water in my glass, or their concept of water refers to something else. And if their concept of water refers to something else, then it can't be a transparent concept. It must be a kind of a topic neutral concept of whatever occupies the water role around here. So twin earthability and transparency, caetus paribus, non-twin earthability, caetus paribus goes together with transparency. If you can't construct twin earth scenarios for a concept, then that's a sign that it's probably a transparent concept. It's not a topic neutrally defined concept. Okay. I've just said most of the stuff that's on this slide. I was talking about the wrong one. Yes, I have. Let me skip through that. So imagine trying to construct a twin earth scenario for a property like being in contact. We can construct them for water, right? Construct them for water, you know, you just imagine that something other than water causes watery experiences, and then you think about what the residents of that world, are they right or wrong to say there's some water in my glass? If they're right, then water's topic neutral, structural, functionally referring concept, okay? So now imagine trying to do that for a property like being in contact. Suppose that contactish phenomenology, the look that we, the sort of phenomenology, let's just suppose this, there is some phenomenology associated with individual contact experience. This is you're now having experience as of two things being in contact. Suppose that phenomenology is caused by the property of being 1 meter apart. And vice versa, I guess. The 1 meter apart phenomenology is caused by things that are in contact. It's already kind of weird, right, to try and imagine a twin earth scenario for a property like this. It's quite easy for water. You just imagine a substance with a different chemical nature. Is tasteless, odorless, colorless, flows in the rivers and such like. When you try and do it for a property like, for a specific spatiotemporal property, like being a meter apart, being in contact, you end up with a very strange situation, right? And you get a lot of discontinuity in the perceptual experience. So imagine what happens when two things move, and they get to 1.1 meter apart, and they look like this, and then suddenly they get to a meter apart, and they give contact-ish phenomenology, and then as they get to 0.9 meters apart, they go back to something like this, and then they keep moving, and as they become at zero separation, then they snap back to giving 1 meter apart type phenomenology. So you can already see that there are a lot of problems constructing twin cases for specific space-time properties like being in contact. So let's ask, what property does their concept, contact, refer to? The property that gives rise to, that causes contact-ish phenomenology in their world, is the property of being a meter apart. So, if their concept of contact refers to the property of being a meter apart, then it's a twin-earthable concept. And if it refers to the property of being at zero separation, like it does in our case, then it's not twin-earthable, and it's probably transparent. So I'm going to think about what the occupants of such a world would say about their phenomenology. And I think they'd say that they were systematically misled by the phenomenology. So when things get to a meter apart, they suddenly snap together and they look like they're in contact. But you can still fit things that are less wide than a meter in between. That's going to look really weird. I don't know how that would look. The phenomenology is like that. Look, I can still slide something between them, and I can see that one on that side, another one here. That's going to be very strange, the phenomenology. And then as they approach being at zero separation, the phenomenology is going to snap back to looking as though they're a meter apart. But now they can't fit anything in between them, even though it looks like there's a gap. So I think they conclude that these appearances are systematically misleading. They'd see things getting closer and closer and closer and closer, and then suddenly snap here. But they can't fit anything in between. I think they would think of their concept of contact as referring to being at zero separation. They would not think of it as referring to the property that normally causes contact-ish experiences, because that's the property of being a meter apart. We've reversed these two properties. They're just going to think they have really systematically misleading, irritating phenomenology. They're going to be able to think of a continuum of distances apart, and it's getting closer and closer and closer and closer, and then it looks like it's a meter apart. But they also have the phenomenology that we associate with contact. It's just that that's caused by things that really are a meter apart. So I think they're going to think they're systematically misled. If they get contact-ish phenomenology, they wouldn't say these two things are in contact. They would say, no, they're actually a meter apart. We're just being systematically deceived by this weird, deviant phenomenology that we've imagined. But that's just what it is for a concept to be not twin-earthable. So Chalmers' case of space-time functionalism about properties heavily depends on concepts like sphericality being twin-earthable. But I think it's very hard to construct twin cases for concepts like contact. And I think the same thing about relative motion. So I think what we should say is that at least some space-time concepts are not twin-earthable at all. They're transparent. Our concept of contact is a fairly transparent way of thinking about things being at zero separation in space-time. And what that means is that the concepts we use to describe the space-time of the manifest image place constraints on their truth makers. Okay. So if a concept like contact refers to anything at all, it can't be to a fundamentally non-space-timey property. If these concepts are transparent, they pick out their reference as the properties they are, rather than functionally, then in order to say true things using those concepts, we better be referring to properties that are not completely different to the way they seem to be. Okay, that's the gist of what I'm saying. So I'm going to go quite quickly through this next bit. So I think Alan is right that the concept of space-time is a functional theoretical concept. It might pick out a fundamental structure. It might not. And if the fundamental ontology turns out to be very unlike anything space-timey, then the concept of space-time might pick out a non-fundamental grounded structure. So that, I think, is topic neutral, concept of space-time. Who knows what that might refer to? It refers to whatever occupies the space-time role. But I don't think the same is true of the ordinary empirical claims that we make about things like meters and pointers. At least some space-time concepts, like space-time property concepts, are at least partially transparent. So I apply the concept of being in contact. If it refers to anything, then it refers to the property of being at zero separation in some space-time. Okay? Can't refer to something completely non-spatiotemporal. If you want it to refer to something completely non-spatiotemporal, you need it to be topic neutral. If it's topic neutral, we should be able to construct twin cases for it, like we can with water, but we can't construct twin cases for it. Therefore, it's probably at least partially transparent with respect to its reference. Again, I've got ahead of myself, said all that already. If I'm right that these concepts are at least partially transparent, then they do place constraints on the truth makers of claims involving them. Okay, that's the gist. So here's the disjunction. Assuming some empirical claims are true, like these two things are in contact, or the meter moved to point position 5 on the dial, assuming those claims are literally true, and some of the concepts we use to frame them are at least partially transparent to their reference, then either the fundamental ontology is not non-spatiotemporal, or it is non-spatiotemporal, and the local beables live in a grounded spacetime. And in that grounded spacetime, they have properties that the transparent concepts pick out. So here's a quick argument for that disjunction. Again, I depend on the idea that some empirical claims are literally true, and not true according to the simulation or true in the fiction. It's not some fancy truth predicate. The empirical claims are literally true. And I think you need that for Bayesian confirmation, as I said earlier. But some of those true empirical claims feature at least partially transparent spatiotemporal concepts. They don't refer by phenomenological roles. They don't refer by scientific roles. They pick out certain properties as the properties they are. If those concepts refer to anything, then they refer directly to spatiotemporal properties. They needn't be completely transparent, obviously, just at least partially transparent. Hence, there must be beables inhabiting space-time that's not too dissimilar to the space-time of the manifest image. So either the fundamental ontology is not wholly non-spatiotemporal, or it is, and the local beables live in a grounded space-time. Before I close, let me just say something quickly about an advantage of thinking in terms of a grounded space-time structure. So I want to be a space-time realist, despite the fact that the fundamental ontology might turn out to be non-spatiotemporal. 2 minutes? Can I have two? Give me 2 minutes. Now, one nice thing about this, if you're a kind of an error theorist about space-time, you just think it's all a simulation, then you've got to tell a truth-making story based on something like topic-neutral reference. You've got to be able to explain how I managed to say true things, how my empirical propositions about dials and pointers come out true, despite the fact that literally there are no dials, no pointers, no spatiotemporal relations. And I spent some time arguing that that story doesn't work, okay? At least some of our spatiotemporal concepts are transparent. So local beables live in a grounded space-time. Structure of the earth. There's an advantage to thinking about them as living in a grounded space-time, which is that it allows for that grounded space-time to be also fundamental and dependent. Elizabeth Barnes has a paper arguing in mind that we should think of ontological emergence as dependent fundamentality, entities that are dependent on something else but are equifundamental. There's no relative fundamentality relation between them. They're on the same fundamentality level. And let me just give you one reason why you might want to say that. So when we do kind of meta-ontological principle is that we ontologically commit to something when it has a genuinely novel causal role, when it does something that nothing else does. But if we take seriously the idea that the fundamental ontology is wholly non-spatiotemporal, I mean now the basic ontology, let me distinguish basic from fundamental. If the basic quantum ontology is wholly non-spatiotemporal, then you might think that that level of stuff depends on what happens in the grounded space-time for its identity. Certainly our criteria of ontological commitment depend on causal powers, causal novelty. And you might even think that the stuff in the basic ontology is individuated by what happens in the grounded space-time. And Naomi Thompson has a paper recently arguing that there are cases like that, symmetric grounding. Her case is one of her cases anyway, is the organs of the body partially ground the body. Okay? They partially constitute the body. But the body is partially the organs are partially individuated by their roles within the body. What makes them the organs they are is what they do within something that they themselves constitute. So you have two different grounding relations. And it's arguably a case of symmetric grounding, where the organs are grounding the body, and the body is reciprocally grounding the identities of the organs. And you might well want to say something similar about the relationship between space-time and the basic quantum ontology, which is I'm assuming to be non-spatiotemporal, at least in quantum gravity. And thinking of space-time as a genuine grounded structure leaves room for that kind of ontology, a symmetric grounding ontology, where the space-time is not only real, but it also plays a role in perhaps individuating the basic entities that ground it. Okay. Let me see. Emergent space-time means we need a truth-making theory for empirical claims. Functionalists want to give you a truth-making theory that's topic-neutral, doesn't depend on the existence of a grounded space-time. I say that stuff doesn't work because at least some of our spatiotemporal concepts are directly referring transparent concepts. They don't have the kind of functional analyses that the Chalmers functionalism requires. So we should think that if the fundamental ontology is not spatiotemporal, then there's a grounded space-time in which the local beables live. And evidence that the fundamental ontology is not spatiotemporal is not evidence that we live in a simulation, it's evidence that we live in a grounded space-time. Okay. Thank you for listening.
Okay, let's start with Chicago, maybe. You have some questions?
Hello?
Yes. Go ahead.
I think it's better, rather than switching the microphone off when the other person is speaking, I think it's better when whichever side is speaking turns off their speakers.
Okay.
Can we try that?
Yeah.
Okay. I'm doing that now. Is it your hair? Oh, okay, then I do. So, I think I'm sympathetic with the conclusion that, if I get this right, is, you know, I like Eleanor's way rather than the Chalmers way. Though, maybe if I have sort of picked it for different reasons, which is, you know, if you're actually trying to construct a physical theory of the mind, or trying to understand it, then like, with the really impossible, you'd be able to do it sort of straight, one grabbed it, just have to develop physical, a spatiotemporal physical theory, sort of anyway. But let me try to, can I just give you, I'm going to do it for a bit, because the second the mic stops makes it a little problematic. But let me it's a sort of way of trying to push back and trying to count, trying to twin the contact action for you. So here's one way the world sort of might be. You know, it might be that in fact there's a sort of extra dimension that we don't, haven't kind of noticed yet, or maybe this is another. Anyway, and what we think of as we think this is happening. Yeah, really, it's like this because they're separated in another dimension. But we're kind of looking down. I guess I can do it like this. Okay. So thinking of this, but really, it's like this. But now my twin earthers are not going to be looking. I'm going to keep my hands in the same orientation, but they're not looking kind of down on this extra dimension. They're looking like this on the side. So we're looking down, we see, I don't know if you're quite getting this, so the contact, because they're looking from a different angle. So contact involves a sort of projection, and the angle of the projection makes a difference to whether you have contact or not. Does that kind of, I sort of actually have a physical theory in mind. This sort of comes up in some space fundamentality, that they have this idea that locality might actually be relative in this way. But I'm not quite sure whether that would sort of be in the direction of twin earthing. So if you get my example, does that make sense?
It does. I guess I don't know. Could we think of it in terms of like a flat line example as well, just to kind of make it more tractable? I mean, because in those cases there's a hidden dimension, but when the flatliners see two things as being in contact, they really are coming into contact along one dimension. They're just not seeing the other dimension. So I guess I'm not seeing how the hidden dimension in this case. So why are they stopping when the two things? Maybe I'm just not seeing exactly how the hidden dimension is supposed to do the work with the phenomenology. Well, let me put it to you this way. In your example, the two things are not at zero separation at all, in any sense?
Right, so I'll come back. Because they're in the different dimensions, if you look at the full number of dimensions, there's still a separation between them. But when you project that sort of three-dimensional picture down to two dimensions, which is kind of the plane of awareness, or you know, plane of phenomenology, there's zero separation of their projections onto the two-dimensional plane.
Yeah, I need to think some more about that, is the answer. I hadn't thought of those sorts of cases. I mean, what do you want to say about those cases? So, do you want to say that in the projection, it's false that anything is really in contact? Or do you want to say that the concept of being in contact refers to some other property than being in zero separation? Whether the concepts are twin earthable or not is going to depend on which way the intuition should go about that question. I'm just interested to know what you're thinking.
Yeah. I don't know, I'm not quite sure what intuitions they have there. I mean, clearly contact action then means, right, zero separation. The concept is sort of zero separation of the projections rather than the full n-dimensional things. That's right.
Yeah,
that's okay.
I don't say that the concepts are fully transparent, but I certainly allow that concept. We might be a bit surprised when we actually find out what contact really is. I just don't think it could turn out to be completely different to the way we ordinarily experience it. So, like, I haven't thought about the cases you have in mind. I have to give that some more thought. There's another kind of where you can try and twin space-time concepts, you can try with relative motion. And I have another case where I think relative motion is going to come out non-twin-earthable as well, for different reasons. But I need to maybe give the context story of what book, bearing in mind what was said. Thank you.
So thanks. I have a finger on that.
Question.
Sorry?
There's a finger in Chuck as well.
Okay. So you go first. Okay, so
yeah, I didn't think I had it. I think I had it, but when we talk about contact, I started thinking about that. The way you talk about contact as being within the sphere of existence, that is already very much in terms of the common sense, it's a whole kind of basic understanding. But just looking at what contact really is in like our, just based on our current understanding of physics, it's pretty complicated. It's not a trivial, I mean, for practical purposes, we can tell it's in zero distance, but what does really happen when a macroscopic object meets another macroscopic object, for instance? There's kind of a blurry edge, and kind of the pushback is very much ultimately connected with the electromagnetic properties of the kind of molecules and atom building up this thing. And is there even a kind of a clear sense of what zero distance would be? Objects we're talking about are not kind of clearly well defined. They are well defined enough for the purposes we're dealing with them, but still kind of at the microscopic level, but kind of at the more fundamental. You also have that kind of trippiness on that concept. So, I mean, would that make any kind of problems of discussing contact in the way we're doing it?
I mean, even the plausible case.
Yeah.
I mean,
it's
important to me that I don't want to be too condescending, right? So it's very important to me when I'm constructing these cases of alleged non-twin inability that I don't claim that the concepts in question are fully transparent. What I really want to end up claiming is that they couldn't be referring to anything that's wholly non-spatiotemporal in character. They might well end up referring to properties that are not like, but that are significantly different to the way we conceptualize them when we think commonsensically about those properties. But when I set up kind of the context to another case, I had in mind that you can't twin earth it by supposing that some different spatiotemporal property gives rise to contact being phenomenology. That's going to give you systematic error rather than truth referring to different properties you need in twin cases. I'd be happy, I mean, if it, obviously it's a story about what it is two things in context, it's going to be a lot more complex than two mirological symbols pushing up against each other and trying to occupy the same point of space. I don't want to go that common sense. So I don't think it's going to create a problem for me. I hope not. Because I don't need to claim that the concepts are fully transparent. I just need to claim that they're sufficiently transparent that they could refer the topic neutrally to a structure that isn't at all spatiotemporal. But I need to be clear about exactly what constraints I'm putting on that and exactly what kind of twin cases I'm using to motivate it.
So maybe I have a thing where really going back for the same along the same dimensions. As I think I told you, we also think about space-time functionalism in the context of the quantum gravity that we launched our project. And so will be joining the team in January. We're writing a paper on that. And it's, as Nick said, it's definitely more of a functionalism like what we have in mind. Now, having said that, I have also a question about the transparency of spatial-temporal properties. And maybe that, you know, you already said they don't need to be fully transparent, and that will answer that question. But the way I would think that they're twin-earthable is in the sense that suppose, you know, there are spatial-temporal locutions such as, you know, this fall is between you and me, and you know, the dinner is after the talk, and you know, things like this that we have, and that are phenomenology in one way or another. Really, what is going on there? Like, is just what it really is H2O is thousands of polarities are true. What we have instead are spinifones, and it's a complicated set of relations among the fundamental constituents of that we see, of the world that we see around us, that ground and give rise to these spatial and temporal relations in our phenomenology. But now comes Twin Earth. On Twin Earth, it's not local gravity, it's causal set theory that is true. So you have the same phenomenology, supposedly, but then it's instead of H2O, it's XYZ. It's different fundamental building blocks together with different fundamental relations that combine in different ways than to give rise to the same phenomenology. So I think in that sense, it seems as if it's perfectly different.
Well, look. I'm not claiming that there couldn't be the same manifest image with a different fundamental ontology. That's absolutely not a claim. I'm attacking this from a conceptual side. So, I mean, the Chalmers and Yates style functionalism, what they're driving in is that we're referring by means of phenomenology to elements of fundamental ontology, whatever it might be. So in a causal set theory, we're picking up causal set theory properties. Quantum gravity will be picking up properties of spin funnels or spin networks by means of the same topic neutral, non-transparent processes. So I'm really looking at this from a conceptual viewpoint. I'm not saying that there couldn't be different fundamental grounds of this ground on space-time. What I'll argue for is that at least some of our concepts refer in such a way that they have to be picking up properties of the ground and space-time rather than somehow bypassing that via phenomenological or topic neutral specifications and going all the way to the fundamental. So I want to argue for the middle in other words. I think in the Chalmers style functionalism, they say, let's cut out the middle. Let's go direct to the fundamental ontology by some truthmaking theory. I want to say that the way the concepts refer, you need the middle in it's kind of, you need to be ontologically realistic about the ground aspect.
Okay, that's very helpful. I mean, I can't speak for Vessel or Nick, but to me that sounds very, very plausible. I wouldn't want to commit to the view that there is no such room there. Maybe that's exactly what is required in that one. That's fine.
I think Ellen is being leaves us up a bit. Right. She leaves open the ontological status of the occupant with the space-time role. It's a nice point, my favorite theory. So I kind of want to argue a little bit of support for her that we should leave it open because it turns out that at least some of the things we want to say can only be made true by something space-time. I mean, they can't be made true by completely non-spatiotemporal ontology.
I guess an historical question, or this is in the current matter taking for taking to be just as a historical interest. I realize recently that I think it refers to almost like the raising problem of empirical coherence. We're not targeting an British, but it was a Russian.
Yes.
but it's all difficult on the law. When you read, say, the relation of sense data and physics, you're bringing the music and logic for the philosophy of logic and so forth. Yes, this problem, which is exactly empirical coherence, is because it doesn't take evidence to be statements about the beables or whatever, but about sense data. Not only we are working with sense data, but physics doesn't talk about sense data. Universal physics is completely different. And the strategy is, we can argue this idea that it's backward because they say, okay, let's construct physics from sense data. Mm-hmm. But of course, we can just say it derives and construct sense data from physics. But my question is more, because this method of production is what he says is we reduce something to something when we show that this is a logical fiction. Or we can translate every statement about that and a statement about a fundamental object. So we can reduce statements about the car comes white, as a statement about the space possible experiences. My question is that, would that account be more similar to your view? Because the answer doesn't deny that there are tables, just that when I say there are tables, I'm making a statement about this data. Or is it similar to the functionalists? Because I'm thinking that was, and I understand
saying per se or not.
Chalmers is certainly not a Russellian phenomenologist. That's kind of Barclay's idealism without God. You know, you just use the phenomenon possibility of sensation, and you somehow logically construct the fundamental ontology out of all the possible sense experiences that you might be having. It's, I mean, it didn't work. This is a huge problem with it. It puts the epistemological part before the metaphysical horse, as Jerry Fogle would say. Whether it's similar to any of them really. It's probably most similar to the functionalist view because at least they want to start with phenomenology and build up conceptual content out of phenomenological specifications. They're at least doing reference fixing in terms of phenomenology. In Chalmers' case, he's trying to write Kahneman's alpha. So in Chalmers' case, it's really important that all the concepts, well, as many as possible, are a priori equivalent to, or a priori defining in terms of phenomenology they give rise to. So he thinks you can do the whole thing just in terms of the notion of fundamentality and phenomenal properties. So you just use whatever fundamental thing normally gives you rise to this kind of experience, and you use that sort of cue to refer to everything. So I would think that Brennan functionalism would be closest to the Russellian position, except that Russell was building up the ontology type of phenomenology rather than just using the phenomenology to refer to fundamental physical stuff. Chalmers certainly thinks there's a fundamental physical ontology as many of us. He thinks consciousness is fundamental too. But he's not building the ontology out of it.
My question is not about the phenomenalism, but about the mechanical stuff. Because it's kind of point that in the physicalistic basis, but the idea is you reduce something and you show, or you translate every statement about that and also statement about the phenomenal ontology. So you can be a realist in the sense that you can be true, yes, there are whatever you want, but you're just making a statement and the positive ontology. Is that a form of consistent review around it?
I wouldn't say so, really. I mean, if anything, it's certainly not what Nate thinks, for instance. It's not really what I think of, I think of the grounding relationship because I want to make sense of the position ultimately in which both the fundamental ontology and the grounded space-time are equifundamental. So you have a basic ontology and a grounded space-time, and they're on the same level of fundamentality, so you can see the grounding relationship as a horizontal one. Vertical relative to the mentality. That's the kind of ontology that I want to drive at because that's the kind of thing that interests me about everywhere else. I'm certainly not trying to do any kind of reductionist program. I think the closest to that would probably be Chalmers, and even then it's just a semantic story. It's a story about the concepts rather than the ontology. It's about how we manage to pick out things in the fundamental ontology. It's about how much you need to be in the fundamental ontology, right? So he's trying to minimize the base as much as possible. And he thinks you should take the spatiotemporal stuff out because you just use that stuff to pick out whatever normally gives rise to certain types of phenomenology. So how much do you need in the absolutely fundamental ontology in order for the maximum amount of truths to be a priori deducible from the basic stuff? So to the extent that he's doing a priori conceptual analysis, I'd say Chalmers is probably closest to the Russellian view, but again, he's not kind of a phenomenologist. So maybe in terms of the method, there are going to be some interesting similarities there.
Well, I
don't
think the Chalmers is also Russellian. So if you're not on the method, thanks, you're both wrong.
Okay.
I'm a little confused about to make sure that the same thing when we talk about the fundamental. For me, fundamental are the concepts that enters, they enter the fundamental laws. Finding pieces in the world, and then everything that you can build, define it for the consider the grammar. It depends on whether you can make it. So this is okay, so we understand.
Yeah.
Okay. Then the second question is it true that the problem that you see in the property version of functionalism is that you want to use some concept beyond its logistic material. Since this is a part of this general problem that sometimes you fall into problems because you want to use some concepts beyond its role, which is defined in the theory.
Not really. I mean, that's not my answer to the problem. So, I mean, on your first point, I have had a different. I mean, there are several different notions of fundamentality. The one that you're picking up as fundamentality, I would probably refer to that as ontological basicness. You have a basic set of things that are non-composites, they don't have proper parts. You have a basic set of properties that are not realized by other properties, they're just kind of. They are what they are, they're kind of essentially maybe powerful. And then the question of whether anything else is fundamental becomes a good question of whether anything is emergent. So is anything that depends on that basic ontology also in some other sense fundamental, i.e., you know, do the causal powers of everything that's dependent on the basic ontology, you know, reduce the powers of something in the basic ontology, or reduce some other link to the basic ontology. If you had a causal notion of ontological commitment and fundamentality, then you might well think that the ground stuff is fundamental, just in kind of if it's sense to basic stuff. So if you take ontological emergence seriously, then you won't want to do fundamentality facts off the basic laws of physics, because you might think there's stuff that depends on the basic physical stuff, which earns its fundamentality in another way. Things could earn their ontological keep in all sorts of ways. But in a particularly in a robust way as well. So I mean, the way I'm thinking about it is maybe. I mean, I started out thinking powers, kind of thinking that basic physical properties like charge are powers, they're individuals, it's like what they do. But if the basic quantum ontology is kind of static, I mean, nothing really happens, or if it's not the kind of thing in which causation takes place, how are the powers supposed to manifest? So you might think you might combine a powers ontology with a non-spatiotemporal basic ontology and say that the powers get their identities from what they do in the ground on space. So I'm thinking of this kind of mutual grounding, mutual dependencies of ontology. It's the kind of thing I'm trying to accept. So I don't have that physics-related notion of fundamentality. As to the objection to property functionalism, I mean, let me go back to the water case. Okay, water is the taste of stuff that comes out of the tap. That seems like a perfectly good reference for H2O in most cases. So there's a stable, non-circular way of referring to H2O by means of the phenomenology that it normally causes. What I think about the spatial-temporal property case is that there's no non-circular way of saying which phenomenology is associated with a particular spatial-temporal property, like being in neutral part, being in relative motion. So that's independent of the transparency argument. The transparency argument clearly needs more work. The negative argument is just that there's no non-circular way of saying what phenomenology is associated with, say, being in contact. Because in order to say what being in contact looks like, you have to say where you are in relation to the contacting things, what kind of things they are, what their other spatial-temporal properties are. So it's just a circularity objection. You can't refer to properties of being contact solely on the basis of the way contacting things appear, because there's no non-circular way of saying how they appear. You would have to go a kind of, there's another option which I didn't mention, you'd have to go for a kind of holistic view according to which we don't apply. If we apply space-time concept on the basis of phenomenology, if we define by phenomenology, you'd have to apply them all at once to space-time, to complex situations in the manifest image. So it's not that there's a phenomenology associated with the property of being in contact or being in relative motion. There's a really complex phenomenology associated with a really complex array of space-time properties. And I kind of reject that, and the same reasons I reject the scientific story, which is just doesn't explain ordinary conceptual complexness with these things. So no, that's not to do with the idea that they use sort of beyond the theory. It's just that there isn't any specific phenomenology associated with two things instantiating a spatial-temporal relationship.
If you want to know what two things instantiate in a particular spatiotemporal relation looks like, you need to know a lot more about the other spatiotemporal properties of the system. So it's not going to be a non-circular way of picking out the phenomenology. Does that answer your question? Felt like I'd run a little bit.
Yes.
So, are there any other questions? Okay, maybe we should shut up.
So, just I want to be kind of fair. Well, first off, what I guess I didn't say the first aspect of how much I really enjoyed this talk and the sort of educational and enlightening about a number of sort of things that I've never really seen this thing before. So just in case I forget to say that. Now my question, I just want to be fair to sort of Renee and Chalmers, because there's a certain sense in which we're talking about quantum gravity, and I think Chalmers isn't, and Renee is mostly talking about configuration space rather than the quantum gravity. But it sounds like both of them are kind of eliminating the space-time before we even get to quantum gravity. But anyway, but can you just comment a bit about, is it really fair to be kind of criticizing them as sort of accounts of quantum, in terms of accounts of quantum gravity functionalism when that's not really what they're talking about?
Well, certainly in this case, if I didn't, then I should have made clear that Nay is talking about configuration space. The reason I attribute kind of a property functionalism to zero is that it's not obvious to me that these kind of areas of high amplitude of the wave function and configuration space really count as coming into contact with each other or moving. I mean, there may be some loose sense in which they get closer and further apart in configuration space, but you can only really make sense of that, I think, if you map configuration space back onto the manifest image and you treat these coordinates as the coordinates as particle 1, these coordinates as particle 2. But many things that you can pick out states like the dial pointing to position 5 as portions of the wave function in configuration space. So because she thinks that the manifest image is purely phenomenological, I think she has to be thinking something along the lines of we pick out a state of affairs in configuration space as whatever's giving rise to the meter pointing to position 5 phenomenology. So I'm attributing that to her not on the basis of anything she explicitly says, but on the basis that she thinks the manifest image is a simulation. She thinks it's purely phenomenological. I mean, she doesn't have to take it. If you think that, you don't really think there are causal interactions going on in the manifest image. They're merely apparent interactions. So to pick out an object by means of its causal role, I first look at the patterns it makes in the phenomenology, and then I pick it out in configuration space by means of a concept that refers on the basis of that phenomenology. So I'm reading a lot into Nate, it's not explicitly there. She certainly, though, as you say, quite rightly, is not trying to isolate bits of the loop quantum gravity by means of phenomenological concepts that refer to the manifest image. Chalmers, on the other hand, I think is. I mean, he explicitly says at various points he's constructing the world that the story, he doesn't go into much detail about it, so I'm not so clear to how committed he is to this way of thinking, but he does say explicitly at several points that the story that he's telling about space-time property concepts is consistent with string theory, loop quantum gravity, in which the fundamental ontology turns out to be completely different from the way we imagined it, because you're just picking things out as whatever it is that normally gives rise to my relative motion phenomenology. If that turns out to be something in loop quantum gravity or something string theory, then Chalmers is fine with that. So, should you be very careful not to attribute to Nay the idea that you're picking out things that she never. She's using about configuration space. You're right. But I think you can read into her work, especially the 2015 paper, a kind of combination of sort of object property functionalism. In fact, Chalmers thinks she can do it over property functionalism.
He doesn't think they need to worry about objects if he functionalizes a space-time problem. Presumably then you need object concepts as well. You can say all the true things you want by means of the property concept alone. Strictly speaking, nobody explicitly in the also speak the combination of object and property functionalism that I talked about. Although I think it's reasonable to attribute something like that to name, you can certainly attribute it to Chalmers, because he does explicitly say that whatever the fundamental ontology turns out to be, he's not really concerned, because we're referring to the topic neutrally on the basis of phenomenology. Did I answer the question?
That was very good. Although I have a little follow up. I turn the speakers off, so you can't make me stop anyway. I just wondered so here's just a thought about you thinking about May, thinking about the configuration space story as you just explained it, it's kind of how I understood it. I mean, isn't it the case that if she's right, you might be able to sort of twin her on her picture? Because, you know, when you sort of draw configuration space, you know, you draw whatever, but you get the zero of the sort of positions of the two particles line up, but maybe there's a way of sort of transposing everything so they don't quite line up. The zero of particle one is sort of goes through 1 meter, you know, goes through one of the axis of particle two, and then kind of rejigger everything so that the phenomenology sort of drops out the same, and that you sort of transpose the dynamics. Is it possible? So I guess the suggestion might be that your non-twinner thing slightly begs the question, I guess, you know, does it sort of assume so much space in the story that you're telling? Anyway, that's something along those lines.
Yeah, you might be right. I need to give you more thought to the twin earth, because I have two separate arguments against this kind of functionalist story of functionalist reference fixing story. One is that the functionalist stories just don't work because the phenomenology isn't available, and then if you do it in scientific terms, you fall afoul of considerations of successive competence. The transparency story. The transparency case is supposed to be kind of a quick, neat way of appealing to Chalmers' heuristic to show directly that the concepts are transparent. And that's always going to be more risky than the other negative case. Because if I can make the negative case stick, then that's fine as far as I'm concerned. Because then the best explanation of how we use these concepts is still going to be that they're a little more or less transparent. Even if I can't quite get the details of the twin case sorted out. But I need to give more thought to those. I don't know what to say to those objections. Thank you very much for the comments. I obviously need a bit more thought to those cases.
I'm sorry, I can't resist. It's asking you about the scientific story and why that doesn't work. Couldn't we just say there, though, that the conditions which we use to pick out the right phenomenology are, you know, they're distinct. There are certain conditions which are available to anybody who's a competent observer, I guess, and that the scientific way, the conditions or criteria to pick out what it is then that fulfills that role, that they don't need to connect. Of course, if there's a sort of co-variation of the two, if there's this is a robust thing, like in the case of water, where we really robust, so whenever we have a chemical compound H2O, we have odorless, transparent, whatever, the phenomenology of water, we will, at the end of the day, want a story of how, that fundamental scientific story, explains, has to explain some of the phenomenology. But it doesn't mean that competent about the chemistry of order.
No, I mean, I think this is not so much what I meant when I said the scientific story. So when I was talking about the scientific story, I was still talking about functionally defined concepts in Chalmers' sense. So the phenomenologist works, and you tell a reference fixed story. It's a definitional story about the content of the concept. So the concept of motion or relative motion content is the concept of something that plays a very specific scientific role. That's what I'm arguing against. Now, the story that you're telling is something like how quickly might tell a quickly Putnam story about how we refer, you might tell a reference magnetism story, something like that. Where the phenomenology just forms a reference fixing role, and then you have an externalist account of what it is that the concept refers to. That's going to be non-transparent, it's going to be perfectly consistent with a no-ground spacetime view where we just somehow refer directly to complex configurations and properties in fundamental ontology using these externally individuated concepts. So it's important for me to argue against that as well. I'll just rather than doing that there, I went straight for the transparency. I mean, very briefly, it's that you can't even use phenomenology as a reference fix. Without appealing to spatiotemporal properties. It's I mean, when we do the water case, we don't just say whatever that is pointed. We say whatever stands in the same liquid as relation to the substance there. So already appealing to other kind of natural finite concepts and stipulate that anything stands in the same liquid as relation to that, that will be the extension of the concept of water. What I think about the perfect Putnam story for spatiotemporal properties is that we're going to have to say something similar. So anything that stands in the same spatiotemporal relation as a property to that, to the spatiotemporal relation, these two things now stand in, will come to an extension of conflict. But that story seems to be presupposed as the properties in question of spatiotemporal rather than not. So I think there's going to be another circularity where we're there, even on the reference fixing story. But I have to flesh out the details of that.
Yeah. Thank you very much.
I have something on the issue side. Now I understand that you do not believe that spatiotemporal properties can be identical to properties specified in the vocabulary of the fundamental theory. There is no identity.
Right.
And now I don't understand why you're saying this can be excluded by the philosophy of Benjamin that expressed. Because we consistently refer transparently to spatiotemporal properties, where in fact identical, they are nothing but.
So you think even if I'm referring transparently to spatiotemporal properties, they still might turn out to be identical to something non-spatial.
Yeah, exactly. Why is this?
Well, I mean, this comes down to the where the consciousness debate is at the moment with philosophy of mind, so I mean, maybe I can make it clearer in that way. But to stop me from running. So if you take, this is the real mystery, I think, now I'm filled in the consciousness, right? We've got the likes of Chalmers, really, and then Lewis is thinking this is getting there. If you take, and it also comes down to why they thought the initial identity theorists thought that mental concepts had to be topic neutral. So the idea is that if the concept of pain reveals the essence of a pain state, and the concept of C5 activity, sorry, neuroscientists, I know that's not what it is, if that reveals the essence of C5 activity, then why don't I know a priori that the two things are the same? If each concept is transparent with respect to its reference, then it seems like a priori that they refer to the same thing. Given that I don't, given the identities are posterior, I need one of the concepts to refer to topic neutrally, and one of the early identity theorists picked were the mental concepts. So pain is just a concept of whatever state occupies that system. Okay. So coming back to Yulby, I mean, if you think that the manifest space-time concepts are transparent, presumably the concepts in fundamental ontology can be even more transparent. It's hard to see how you could have an posterior identity between two. And it's also hard to think if you have a transparent concept of something spatiotemporal. If it's just partially transparent, then the thing it refers to better be sufficiently like the way you can see it. That's what it is for a concept to be transparent. So that kind of rules out like referring to anything completely non-spatiotemporal in fundamental in the basic quantum ontology. One disjunction that I argued before was that the fundamental ontology isn't non-spatiotemporal at all. I mean, maybe that's what you're getting. I'd be perfectly happy with that. If I can establish that disjunction, either the basic ontology is not non-spatiotemporal, or there exists a ground on space-time when we refer to these transparent, partially transparent space-time concepts, I'll be happy with this judgment.
Okay, I'm afraid we have to stop you because we're already 15 minutes over time.
Sorry.
So please join me in thanking David again.